Hi, everyone. My name is Natalie Yeadon. I'm the CEO and co-founder with Impetus Digital. At Impetus Digital, we have built some of the best-in-class asynchronous and synchronous virtual collaboration and communication tools. We have worked with pharmaceutical companies from across the globe over the past 13 years to help them with everything from different virtual insight gathering programs to peer influence programs, to virtual education. We've been working with patients, payers, allied healthcare providers, and physicians with pharmaceutical companies to help them with strategy, education, ambassador programs, investigator programs, and everything in between. But what really differentiates us is we don't just have the software platform, but we also have real people working with the pharmaceutical companies to help them every step of the way. So our white glove service. But more importantly, at Impetus, we really believe that everything starts with a conversation. And from these big, hairy, audacious conversations with some of the leading edge thinkers, some of the digital provocateurs, as well as the healthcare thought leaders, is we can all work together to collectively and positively disrupt healthcare. So I'm very pleased to have one of these healthcare thought leaders at the table with me today. He is actually a very passionate and solution-driven sales and marketing leader. He has a proven track record of driving business growth and strategy. Roland brings over 30 years of pharmaceutical and medical device experience to his company now called eSight. He has spent the last 20 years in ophthalmology and sales, marketing, as well as various strategic roles of increasing responsibility. Roland has also launched multiple surgical technologies in the ophthalmology sector in both the anterior and posterior segments. With focused strategic execution, Roland has driven many brands to market-leading positions. And likewise, his passion and experience are now bringing eSight technologies to people with central vision loss. So happy to have you on the show, Roland.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the kind introduction.
And we are also equally excited about having one of our very special guests on the show today. This Roland has brought along Gary Foster. He is actually one of eSight's happy customers, and he is actually here to share firsthand his experience with living with macular degeneration. Welcome, Gary. So happy to have you on the show.
Happy to be here.
Awesome. So let's actually get started, Roland. You and I just had a quick little dialogue before the show started about your really interesting career. You've been in the industry for a long, long time, much of your time in ophthalmology. Maybe you can just give a little bit of explanation of how you ended up working at eSight and a little bit about your career trajectory.
Sure. As you already said, I started life in pharmaceuticals and both marketing and sales, and then transitioned to ophthalmology on the device side. And I spent close to 20 years in a marketing capacity, managing glaucoma surgery, mm-hmm. cataract surgery, retina surgery, refractive surgery, you name it, both on consumables and on the capital equipment side. And also ran a sales force for one of the companies involved in retinal surgery. And I've always loved the impact that these technologies had on patients. And when I came across an opportunity with eSight, and probably like yourself, checked out the website and saw the impact that this technology was having on people's lives. You know, they have users, or we have users from 6 years of age all the way to 100. So it isn't just a certain demographic that can benefit. And having people regain independence, being able to live on their own, going back to work, continuing with their education, it's just tremendous. So it just spoke to my values and what I want to accomplish in my career. They have a great product, and there's been a strategic shift for eSight to really bring the product from a direct-to-consumer kind of digital marketing entity into the healthcare professional space, and having patients recommended to the product and referred to us for a telehealth program.
Beautiful. Absolutely love it. We obviously see Gary with the device, but maybe you can tell us, before we get started into the details of it, is maybe tell us a little bit about the eSight story and what specifically eSight is.
Sure. So the story is actually a great one. It really comes from a place of inspiration. Our founder's name is Conrad Lewis. He was an electrical engineer in Ottawa. And both his sisters were diagnosed and lost central vision due to Stargardt's disease, which is a juvenile form of age-related macular degeneration. So he was really inspired to help his sisters just get back to a normal life and being able to see. So, you know, being the engineer that he was, he just started tinkering in his basement. And after years of trying different approaches and different technologies, he came up with the original eSight, which was brought to market in 2013. So ever since then, it's evolved into today's product, where we obviously have had technological improvements, both on the software and the hardware, as advancements have come in the last decade.
Phenomenal. So we have. So tell us a little bit about the actual hardware and maybe a little bit about the software. Tell it, sure. You know, I think people would be very interested since this is a type of a medical device, is there's always questions about the regulatory pathway. Tell us a little bit about how it was built and really how it got approved.
Sure. So it's a class one medical device. So the medical device burden isn't as stringent as it would be, you know, in a an implant or a pharmaceutical product. So it follows a traditional class one device, both in Canada and FDA. As far as the product itself goes, it's a wearable device. So it's a relatively nascent space in healthcare. So you actually wear this. It's a headset, and some of your viewers who are seeing this can probably see Gary wearing it. So it is a visor that's in front of your eyes, which you can tilt up slightly or all the way, depending on what you need. There is a halo that comfortably fits around your head, which spreads the weight. It weighs about a pound. And there's a battery on the back, small of your neck, which gives you a nice balance of the technology. So there's no real pressure spots or discomfort as you're wearing it. And the way the technology really works is there is a HD camera on the front of the device that captures everything the person's looking at but can no longer perceive because of the central vision loss. It runs it through a software algorithm, which enhances the image, but will also allow the wearer to manipulate the digital signal to optimize it for their needs to be able to perceive it. On the other side of the visor are two OLED monitors, so basically two small televisions, one in front of each eye. And the user uses peripheral vision, parafoveal vision, and whatever central vision may be left to get that digital stimulus to the optical cortex, the vision cortex. The brain processes it just like any other vision. And as you manipulate the image on the screen with magnification, with brightness, with contrast, with color filters, all the things the software brings to the equation, the blind spot literally just shrinks away. So we take many users from, you know, 2400, 2600 to 20, 20, 2030 distance vision, reading vision. And we really target individuals with 20 over 80 is really where it starts to get interesting, to 20 over 800 vision. And many of them benefit from a tremendous impact on their visual acuity.
It just sounds absolutely phenomenal. It does make one, you know, and again, a layperson like myself who doesn't understand the real science behind how this is all created is, and the software technology, it makes one think, well, if somebody was close to blindness or really didn't have, like, how would it work? And the other question is there machine learning or digital algorithms that read and I guess create a customized version of the software specifically for each individual?
So it doesn't create something for each individual, because what's really interesting about how the technology is set up, it is agnostic to the actual disease that's causing the central vision loss. So whether it's AMD, Stargardt's, diabetic retinopathy, or the other conditions that we can help with, it's really about how the disease presents itself, which is central vision loss. So if a patient has a retinal disease or pathology that causes that central vision to diminish, but it maintains the peripheral vision, our software or our technology works very, very well. So it's not really adapting to specific diseases like a therapeutic would do. It's really about how do we address the symptomology of the disease that is coming forward for the user.
So what kinds of eye conditions would your technology help to enhance or increase their vision? What sorts of patients would be able to use this?
Yeah, the biggest one is age-related macular degeneration, whether it's a wet or dry. With dry right now, the only intervention is vitamins, although there are some therapeutics with the FDA for under submission. For wet AMD, of course, there are a number of anti-VEGF injections that manage the disease and slow progression. But once you've had vision loss on either from either one, it's really difficult to get it back. Even anti-VEGF will give you a few letters back. We can talk about what we can bring a little bit later in the conversation. But that's really where we are.
Amazing. I'm going to actually switch things over to Gary, who's been sitting there quietly with your wonderful eSight technology on. Maybe we can actually start a little bit, Gary, with your story and what you presented and some of the initial challenges you've had with your vision.
Well, I was a very active person, and I was involved in a lot of various, really different things, from being a fireman to being a pilot to being a justice of the peace. I was really involved in my community and very, very outgoing. And when I started to lose my vision, I was living in a national park in Canada, and I had a very demanding job, and I was responsible for a very large area, and it meant a lot of driving to go from site to site. When I started to lose my vision, and I was no longer able to drive anymore, then I lost my job. And losing my job, living in a national park as I did, it also meant I no longer had a need to reside in the community where I had served for 34 years. So I had to move. I left some of my children were there with their families. I had to move away. So it wasn't just that I lost my vision, which is bad enough. I lost the ability to do all of the things that I love to do. And I had to move away from an area where I had lived all my adult life. So it was pretty traumatic. And I can remember when we moved into the city, and I'm not a city guy. my wife worked very close to home. She was able to continue her career, but there was nothing for me to do. And I was so active before, the idea of sitting around just didn't work for me. And I guess, according to my family, I started to withdraw. I wasn't as social as I used to be. It's hard to be social with people when you can't see their faces anymore. When you're having a conversation with someone, you get automatic feedback just from an expression on their face. When you lose that, you start to feel a little more uncomfortable about having those conversations because you don't know how you're received. And so I just started to avoid it more and more and more. So I started to withdraw a little bit. I really missed all of the things that I loved doing. With no central vision, I couldn't do them anymore. And I joined the Canadian National Institute for the Blind, just anything that I could do to be active. I was an ambassador for them, and I spoke at different events. And then I was at one of those events, and my wife and my sister saw this vendor, and they grabbed me and they said, "You've got to come and see what this guy has. He says that you'll be able to see if you look through it." And I tried so many things you can imagine, and I didn't want to go. I just said, "No, I'm listening to this lecture. I'm happy where I am." And I lost that battle. So out into the hall I went, and there was this gentle giant standing there with a pair of eSight holding them up. And there was a queue, all these people lined up to look through this eyewear. And he was talking to people on his other side because there was so many people asking questions. So when it was finally my turn and I was able to look through the eyewear, I just froze. And my wife said, "What can you see?" And I said, "I see your face." Mm-hmm. And she started to cry. And I looked around the room and I said, "I see everybody's face." And then I heard him say, "Next." And that was it. You can imagine. It was like somebody sucked the air out of the room. So I had to know more. I went back to the lecture hall when eSight was giving a presentation. I went and I listened in and found out, this was back in 2015. And I found out that it was very expensive at the time. It was $15,000 US. And so I just felt, wow, that's really too bad. You know, I'm not working anymore and that kind of thing. And I had to go to Toronto a couple of months later because we had a brand new grandbaby born and we wanted to go see the baby. And because Toronto was where eSight's headquarters were, I said to my wife, do you think it'd be all right if I went and had a look? And she said, of course, because she was really excited about it. So I went in there, made an appointment, and I went through the full assessment. And the, I think what I wasn't prepared for was how powerful the device was. I was able to read to the bottom of the eye chart. I could see everything. I could see, like, just normally, I could pick up all of the details that I would have been able to before I lost my central vision. Now, since that time,
so Gary, sorry to interrupt you, but what? Yeah. Why did you lose your vision? What was the original issue?
It was age-related macular degeneration. Very, very common in my family, more so than most. Many of my family members have it. And so I was familiar with the condition. I just wasn't familiar with what it would really mean to me, you know, as far emotionally. But when I was getting the assessment, I asked again how much was the product, and they told me, and I was a little embarrassed, and I didn't want to say, oh, that, you know, I can't afford it. I just got up and I said, well, I really appreciate your time. Thank you very much. And I'm trying to get out of there. And my wife said, where are you going? And I said, well, let's go. Like, we found out everything we need to know. And my wife said, well, aren't you going to buy it? And I said, Tammy, it's $15,000 American. And she just looked at me and she said, what would you do if I needed it? And I said, if you needed it, I'd buy it. And she turned to the lady and she said, you take American Express? And that's how I got my first eSight. Now, my eyes have changed drastically since 2015. I'm on my fourth generation of eSight. But I can honestly say that now my acuity is 20 over 400. And even now with eSight, I can still read to the bottom of the eye chart. I have 20/20 vision when I wear my eSight. It absolutely blows me away. But more than that, it gave me back my independence. I mean, I can't drive a car, and I'll never drive a car again. But I can travel like anyone who doesn't drive in taking public transportation. I don't need any assistance. I can call an Uber on my cell phone. I can take it to the airport. I navigate through the airport completely on my own with my eyewear. I travel all over North America unassisted. And I mean, it's just a thrill, because when you are unable to be independent, it's devastating. I mean, it really, really is. It's not just the things that you used to do that you want to do. It's that there's so many things that everybody takes for granted that you just can't do. 100%. No point going shopping. You can't read the items on the shelf. You can't read the prices. You know, you can't do anything like that.
Yeah. So Gary, nothing short of an absolute miracle. And it's just amazing. I do have to ask you, though, that from a personal experience standpoint, you know, sometimes people have a difficult time wearing glasses, even in general. So tell us a little bit about the experience, your experience wearing something that's fairly hefty, heavy, a little bit awkward. Do people ask you if it's virtual reality glasses? How do you kind of navigate that part of it?
Well, in the beginning, in 2015, it was very rare to see. And I would be challenged, even at airports, you know, especially. I got pulled out of the line at Pearl Harbor because they were very suspicious of what I was wearing. But once they found out what it was, they treated me like a celebrity. But anyway, people would often come up and say, excuse me, what are you wearing? Or they would say, hey, man, are you gaming? You know, that kind of thing. And I would just smile. And my wife and I loved those encounters because we're so excited about what this has done, not just for me, but for my wife and my whole family. Mm-hmm. I mean, so we'll talk to anybody about it. So when we're asked, we'll stop whatever we're doing. And that's just a good time for us, because when people understand what it is, they're blown away. Absolutely blown away.
Such a wonderful, wonderful story.
Well, yeah, I don't feel awkward about wearing it anywhere. We're all different. Some people may maybe feel a little self-conscious if they're out in public with something like this. But the way I say it is, it gave me my vision back. I wouldn't care if it had a propeller on top.
Absolutely. I think it looks really cool, Gary. So
yeah,
I think it's awesome.
Gary said something profound there, if I can just interrupt for a second. because, you know, we're always focused on the benefit to the patient and how we get the patient back to a normal life, if you will. But it impacts all the people around the individual as well, because if someone is without sight, they do have a certain dependence on their caregivers, their kids, their parents, their spouse. And when you give that individual the ability to do things on their own again, it impacts the entire ecosystem around them. So it's a very profound little statement that Gary slipped in there, but it can't be understated.
100%, and I'm sure it's made a huge difference in everybody around that. So Gary did bring up an interesting point, and that is the price of this kind of technology. I'm curious, Roland, if you can explain, and if there was a history or a change or a natural progression in this history on the business model. Like, what is eSight's business model? Who's the payer? Who's your target audience, and who do you sell to?
Sure. So the business model I touched on a little bit earlier. So it started off out of necessity, just being a direct-to-consumer product, using digital marketing means to drive it. And because you're really looking for, you know, the 3 million people in North America that would benefit from it potentially, unfortunately, the number is growing, you know, the acquisition cost is relatively high. So one of the reasons I'm here is to really change that strategy from going from direct to consumer and finding one consumer, selling one product, to, you know, engaging with HCPs, finding a clinic that wants to partner with us, and finding hundreds of patients. So it's much more efficient. And what that allows us to do is to reduce the acquisition cost of that purchaser. So the price has, with various versions and our changed business model and cost structure, has come down significantly. So right now we are $69.50 US. So that's about just shy of $9,000 Canadian. And with physician referral, we give a $1,000 discount. And our telehealth program is free of charge. Whereas if you were just to come at us through our website, we charge for shipping and handling for that, which is about $250 Canadian. So that's the business model. Price point, as I said, has come down from the early days where it actually was 20,000 at one point, then to 15, and then now to where we are. And of course, we're always have R&D investments in new projects and new products. And one of the goals is, several goals actually that come up today, is one, make it sleeker, lighter, more glasses-like, and then of course, making it more cost-effective. And as you know, as we, as our volume goes up, our pricing come down as well. So it's those steps towards our growth that allow us to drive price down.
So the question comes down, Roland, if this is a similar thing to, for example, an iPhone. As you create new models, do people sort of step up and pay for the latest model? And then is this also like a Tesla? Is it going to be automated or connected virtually so that new software can be downloaded? Tell us a little bit about how that would work.
That's a great question. So it is on Wi-Fi compatible. So there's a couple of things we can do with that. We can certainly software upgrades, and we have that really increases the longevity of the product. But like any technology, there's a lifespan. So we have had many of our early customers upgrade to the current product, because it's more comfortable, it has better monitors, better camera, easier to navigate software, it's more comfortable, all those things. So they see value. And you know, depending on where they are and how old the product is, we try to work with them as well to give them some trade-in value. So that will be the case for future generations of eSight product as well. With respect to kind of learning and using technology to improve, we can pull data from units. So one of the projects for future products is that you use machine learning and artificial intelligence to have the product monitor how the person's using it and then automatically go there. So that's a future generation type project. Currently, we also use the connectivity to help our users. So it hasn't come up yet, but when you decide to become a user of eSight and purchase an eSight, you're actually assigned a coach. So you have a personal coach, and it comes with 5 hours of coaching time. Most people use probably about 3 of them to really get to learn the product, but they can call anytime and get some help. All those coaches are also users. So they have visual impairment, one of the diseases that we help with central vision loss. And so they're not only experts on product use, but they can relate to the person on the other side. They understand what they're going through and how to best approach it to help them. And if need be, those coaches can get into their device remotely. So they can help them with settings, navigate the menus, much like the IT department can get into your computer when you need help and do diagnostics. We can do the same thing remotely. You can also, through our app and through our remote connectivity, if you're having trouble and your sister lives across town, you can give her access to see what you're seeing. So now she can help you. So you have that infrastructure. So there's lots of things around the user from a connectivity perspective that makes it user-friendly, upgradable, and if you're having trouble to get support instantaneously. So that's how we're using the technology at this point.
We see a lot of this happening these days where policemen are wearing video cameras and things like that for security reasons, et cetera. Is this equipped at all for recording what people are seeing for security purposes or other reasons?
Yeah, so it is capable of taking photographs and video. If you are taking a video, there is a privacy light that does go on in the front of the device so people know they're on camera, which is part of the regulations that are coming. We're already compliant to that. And then of course you can share that video, download it, et cetera. One of the applications and the reason it's on there is because one of our core demographics that we like to help are students, because you just set up for a much better life if you can get your education. Of course, with visual impairment, not all education is easily accessible. Our device makes it accessible because you can interact in the classroom just like everybody else, but you can take photographs of the lecture board as an example and then download that so you can focus on listening and not get lost in trying to take notes, similarly with video. There's also functionality which we call freeze frame. So think of it as a sort of a temporary photograph. So as an example, if you are reading a book, you can take a freeze frame of the entire page of the book. Now you can zoom into it and it just floats in front of you. So wherever you're looking, that page is floating in front of you. And now you can read it like a billboard. So you can manipulate it however you need to make it easier to see. So that can also be used if someone has a slight tremor in their head because they're wearing the device on their head. If they have a shake, that of course then the camera is shaking, but you can use freeze frame that neutralizes that because it just moves with you. So it does have those capture capabilities for a variety of applications. But the issue was, Gary mentioned that he was at Pearl Harbor. That was the issue. Does this take video? Because they don't want video taken at the Pearl Harbor Memorial.
Right. Interesting. So little nuances here, there are advantages, but we have to think about compliance, regulatory, privacy issues, et cetera. On that whole point about what, the latest and greatest, we talk a lot about DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion. I'm curious about the opportunities for employers. And then from there, I guess, insurance programs, insurance policies, being able to get underrepresented, underprivileged, people with other conditions, et cetera, back in the workforce. Is there a play for that? And if so, how are employers incorporating this?
So it's a great topic of discussion. We're a very small company with 27 employees working to push boulders up hills. That is definitely on our radar screen. We have to put our resources where we can. So right now it's driving awareness and partnerships with healthcare professionals, but this is an awesome product for the workplace. And the reason is, if you are visually impaired in the workplace, right now you probably have a CCTV, you have a handheld magnifier, you have special software on the computer, but then you go to the boardroom, you can't see what's being presented, those kind of things. Whereas eSight takes all those tools that are out there, it sort of puts it into eSight. So think of it as the Swiss Army knife of all these various devices that people are using. So now you can have one device at your workstation, in the boardroom, in the lunch hall, and it does everything all those other tools can do. And you can actually take your computer monitor and with an HDMI cable, plug it into the eSight, and now all the software that you use to manipulate the video you're taking as you're looking around, now you can apply it to the computer screen. So the headset becomes your computer screen. So that takes out the expense of software, for example, or if someone has a workstation at work and a different computer at home, now you're not buying software twice because it's always on the eSight. So it's a great product for the workplace, as well as for school, for similar reasons. We do have some companies that have purchased it for their employees, but it's not many, it's very nascent. And you also asked about payers. So in Canada, it's not covered, outside the exception being Alberta, which funds $2,000 every 3 years towards it. If you have a flexible healthcare plan where you have a kind of a cash account, you could use that. In many cases, you could take your eyeglass coverage, which is often not a lot, but you could apply that. But we are working with payers to try and get better coverage. The one place that we have coverage is in the US, and that's Veteran Affairs covers it 100%. Mm-hmm. So, which is actually a relatively difficult coverage to get. So we were very fortunate. We also qualify as a service-disabled veteran-owned small business. So we get a pretty high priority among the VA system in the US. So that's very, very helpful. But private insurance is still a challenge at this point, and public payers is as well.
Well, that's beautiful. It sounds like you're on a great reimbursement trajectory there, Roland. So the key area of focus is presenting this to healthcare providers and then having them prescribe it to their patients. Their automatic question is, how do I know this thing works? What is the clinical trial basis for this? And from that, are there future clinical trials associated with this device?
Yeah, great question. So we have validated our claims in a clinical trial that was published in the Journal of Optometry and Visual Science. And what we were able to demonstrate, small trial, single arm, because it's hard to do a placebo group with something like eSight, obviously. But we showed 7 lines of visual acuity gain. So that takes you from the top of the eye chart to the 20/20 line, which is phenomenal. And to put that in perspective, if you have wet AMD and you're being treated with one of the anti-VEGF medications, you can get in the real world a few letters back. We give 7 lines back. So it's a tremendous impact on your distance and reading of visual acuity. We give 12 letters of contrast back, which again is a phenomenal increase in your contrast sensitivity. Facial recognition was significantly improved. And that's not just about being able to see you as when I'm talking to you, getting those cues. There are a tremendous amount of data points pointing at the mental health challenges that come along with central vision loss. And that's one of the key factors is you don't get those visual cues when you're communicating with people. And much like hearing loss, people tend to withdraw because of that. So that's a big one that we help there from a very practical perspective. And one of the things where we're also unique is we don't impair mobility at all. So there are technologies out there that are VR goggle based. So you're fully immersed, which is great for watching movies, for reading, but you can't ambulate with that because you can't see, your peripheral vision is completely blocked. With our device, as you see with Gary, is his peripheral vision below and to the side is completely unobstructed. So he can actually navigate using his peripheral vision. So he can navigate the airport. He can see that you're in front of him. He just can't see who you are because he can't visualize your face. But now he can have the visor slightly tilted up, navigate with his peripheral vision. And then when he needs to see your face or read the departure board or see what gate it is, he just glance up into the goggle momentarily, more kind of like a reverse bifocal. And then he says, oh, yep, that's my gate, and off you go. So That is a huge differentiating factor for us. And that is why we give so much independence back, because now you can go to the mall and read the price tags, navigate safely, or the grocery store, or walking around town and getting the right bus or the right Uber, because now you can navigate and have that reading vision at your or that central vision at your disposal.
Yeah, phenomenal differentiator versus probably other devices of similar nature, and great building up on those endpoints in future clinical trials as well.
For sure. And you asked about future trials, so there's always ideas of things we want to do and investigate. As a matter of fact, I had a discussion this week at a clinic with some ideas, and it's just a matter of allocating resources and prioritizing our funds.
Absolutely. Gary, you've been living with this wonderful device for many years now. It sounds like it's changed your life. I'm curious about your predictions or maybe even some of your hopes for some of the future technologies or therapies or other things that you see, maybe targeting vision loss. What do you see for yourself or for others?
Well, I can't speak much to the clinical side. I mean, you know, with regards to future surgeries and that kind of thing, but as a wearable device, it's really come a long way. I know that the development hasn't stopped, probably never will really stop. It'll, you know, as technology improves, we take advantage of that. But for me, what I think is really great about this is there's no risk. There's no surgery involved. I just simply put it on and I see, you know, it's not causing me any, you know, any anxiety or anything like that. I simply just put it on, just like people do when they put their glasses on so they want to be able to see better. I put the eSight on so I can see, period. So I'm really excited about improving you know, cameras and OLEDs and that kind of thing. I've actually had the luxury of working alongside the engineers with eSight over the years because they've actually learned to take advantage of someone in my position. I mean, they get all the technical stuff, but I've surprised them a few times with things that I've been able to do that they didn't anticipate. And so when it comes to building a next generation device, I've been able to be involved in that, which I find very, very exciting. And and I hope that it'll always be that way, because that way I get to, I'm their frontline guinea pig, if you will. And I love it.
That's awesome, Gary. So, so exciting. Roland, what's next for you? You've got so many different things. You're sort of a new fledgling and a very exciting, you know, growing company. What's kind of next for you and eSight?
Yeah, I mean, we're working very, very diligently to partner with ophthalmology clinics and HCPs in general that deal with AMD, diabetic retinopathy, and Stargardt's disease, anybody who treats diagnosis central vision loss. So one of the projects we have going is to drive that through a sales force. So we're working on a partnership in the U.S. for a low vision channel, and we're actually looking for partnerships for the MD channel within North America. So we certainly want to be that household name that when physicians see that patient and they have, you know, 20/200 vision due to central vision loss and there's nothing they can do for them because they're dry AMD, that they go, hey, you're a great candidate for an eSight, and refer to our telehealth program and give them their functional vision back. So becoming a household name, if that was the next thing, that would make me very, very happy, obviously. And in the meantime, we want to continue on the investment that we have with our R&D projects, both in improving the form function as well as the functionality of the product. To, you know, could we monitor disease? Could we be diagnostic in some fashion down the road? So there's lots of ideas that we have for our kind of scientific roadmap, if you will. But it's, you know, it's time and money at the end of the day. So right now we're focused on building those partnerships, driving awareness with the HCP channel, and building partnerships and building that trust so that they feel good about referring their patients to us. And I think we're in the starting gate, but we're on a good path.
Yeah. It's a very exciting time and such a treat to see this, and certainly being able to interact with Gary. It'll be really interesting to see with the new, you know, drugs out there in terms of potential partnerships and augmentation or combinations. I'd love to see, you know, eventually these virtual reality glasses, augmented vision, and who knows what's in store. So very excited to see what the future holds. If anybody's interested in connecting with Roland on a series of different topics, connecting, partnering, learning more, please look for his details, contact details in the show notes below. If you like this show, we really appreciate it if you could check out also impetusdigital.com. These are the conversations that we have on a regular basis with patients, physicians, allied healthcare providers, and all sorts of people, asynchronously and synchronously through a series of touch points with pharmaceutical and medical device companies as they help to plan new strategies and ideas and how they're moving their brands forward. And we actually help them through this every step of the way with our white glove service. Please like and subscribe to our channel. We'd really appreciate it if you could also leave us some feedback on iTunes. Please also we would appreciate any kind of feedback that you could give us. Thank you, everybody, for your time today. Thank you, Roland and Gary, for a fantastic conversation.